Goed. Henk, are there questions?
Sure, Herman. Yeah, we have at least two questions here. The first one is, why do religions like Buddhism, but also other religions, degenerate again and again?
Yeah, that's a very good question. That is even a challenge we have within, let's say, in the theosophical literature and activities. The problem is that I address it a little bit in the first block by saying you have to investigate for yourself the truth of the ideas we're telling you. And that is very important, because otherwise, if you believe and you passed on that belief, that other people start to do an interpretation again. And then you get interpretation on interpretation on interpretation. And then you will see that even in a short amount of time, the original teachings is degenerated. And if you compare the later ones with the original ideas, that can be really a huge difference in it. So it is part of the way of rethink. If you start to believe and not investigate, if you investigate and you really try to understand this, then you are able to maintain the original idea. But if you start to believe and you don't investigate, then you get belief on belief on belief. It is the same what you have on school. If you get, for instance, teachings in mathematics, then there are also there the challenge. What do you do? Do you try to memorize it? How you have to calculate with triangles, the surface of the triangle? The square, or do you try to understand? And if you try to understand and you realize that a triangle is always a half square, then you know immediately the equation you need for calculating the surface of a triangle. If you have memorized it, then of course it can be able that you lose that, and that you're losing, I cannot say the knowledge, because it was never knowledge. It was just what we say sometimes, a trained monkey situation. Yeah, look for yourself. If you do an exam for your school or whatever, how long after that exam are you able to do the same type of questions what you have to do for your examination? And there you see immediately that the ones you have memorized, they will lost in a year. The ones you really understand, you can maintain them for many years. There's no problem at all. Yeah. And that is the same with philosophy and religion. If you don't apply it and investigate, it is not something becoming of yourself, and it is just a type of memorizing.
Yeah. I think that's clear. There is a next question, and that is, what is the relationship between detachment, so emotionally being uninvolved, and compassion.
Compassion. There's a huge difference in it. I will explain it in the coming block further in more detail, but I will still give an answer. The emotional feeling most of the time is that we are touched by observation. We see, we speak, we hear, we see TV, we see all the problems people have over the world. We come touched by it, we donate, and let's say the next day it is over. Of course, we remember that we have done donations, but that moment of touchment is away. If you look from compassion and you really realize that we are one and really integrated, and that last one is very easy to see in this world, but if you realize that we are integrated, then you can realize every day what I do. I buy something. I do something. I stimulate a certain way of thinking in the society. You can immediately realize that there is a consequence, not only for yourself, or let's say the direct person touched by it, but in fact for the whole. And if you see nowadays, of course, with all the discussions on the whole climate subject, you will see easily that what we do in the Netherlands, although we are a very small country, have effect much and much further over the world. And what has happened in the world, for instance, if they cut all the forests in Brazil, yeah, we know that the weather climate will change. So there you get the sensation and the insight, the knowledge of the interconnectedness. So, and that is the huge difference. One, you can say, is really based compassion on insight and facts. And the other one is touched by emotional observations and so on.
May I have? Yeah? I think, Herman, what you said is clear, but the question was somehow different, because the questioner meant not attachment,
yeah,
so that you are touched by the senses, but just the opposite.
Yeah.
A person who is not easily touched, mm-hmm, because he stands above the outer world and standing above it.
Yeah.
And is that the same as compassion?
Yeah. No, that's certainly not the same. I'm happy with your correction, Henk. That is certainly not the same, because we can call the separateness, well, in fact, that is this, what we're speaking about. The separateness is let's say, maintaining and let growing the feeling that you are not interconnected. And then you come on the adagio, what you see over the world on the moment, me first. That is what you see very much. And me first will bring a lot of problems. Yeah? Because we are not separated. We are interconnected. So what we do affects others. And on the moment you separate yourself from it, is an effect of illusion. And I say already in the bullets for speaking a little bit about Buddhism, that feeling of separateness is the worst from Buddhist point of view what you can have. It's also the worst what you can have from theosophical point of view.
So even when that it is a separateness in a spiritual level, so someone who just likes to be in spiritual thoughts,
yeah,
and that all the things which is happening in the outer world do not touch him anymore.
No, true. Yeah. That is a part of my lecture 2 weeks from now. When I'm speaking about the avatars, I have also to speak about a type of Buddha, what we call Prajñā. That means for himself. And that is strongly related with the teachings of the avatar, because that type of Buddha, how do you say that, create for himself a big isolation. An isolation so strong that he needs help to be able to come out of that isolation. Okay, the avatar teachings is not the most easiest one. I will do my best to explain it, but I will also take in that lecture the two type of Buddhas, the Buddhas of compassion and the Buddhas, what we call the Prajñā Buddha. And that separation is what we don't like from Buddhist point of view and also not from theosophical point of view. Yeah?
That was, those were the questions.
Thank you. Thank you. So let's make a begin. That compassion is also the fundamental basis for universal brotherhood. So, in fact, that are two terms what you can find in our literature, but the meaning is almost the same. Yeah? If we explain compassion a little bit more, that is acting from knowledge and understanding. Unconditional love, with capital, without expecting any appreciation, without any reward expecting from what you are doing. You help for the help. You are willing to bring teachings because you are convinced and experience yourself that this type of teaching help other people to understand their life and how they can live that life with a minimum of suffering and so on. Yeah? Compassion is not pity. Based on knowledge of oneness, the logic results from it and understanding can be built and they are not equal to each other. Yeah? Morality is not based on feelings, but on a knowledge and an insight. Separateness is an illusion, is a blindness. Yep. If we have to explain which principles is compassion based on, and that is something what the, let's say, the investigation will start on your side, is on the moral universal principle. Yeah. The universal brotherhood as another, let's say, face of the same idea. Yeah. The other word for compassion. Universal brotherhood in our principal point of view is genderless. Although the brother idea is in the word, but it is by definition genderless. It is nothing excluding, everything belongs to it, all different kingdoms from, let's say, human kingdom till the elemental kingdoms, but also the kingdoms of the gods belongs to it. It is one total concept. And a very strong expression you can find in the Mahatma letters, that are the letters written in the time of Blavatsky to H.P. Sinnett and the Mahatmas, were the teachings of Blavatsky, and that subject is very much addressed in that letter, and special in letter number 12, and you will see this letter as one of the readings for the next Sunday evening. There is the chief, so that is the boss of the Mahal Chowans, of the Chowans, and he say very clearly, we want to have a brotherhood of humanity, a real universal fraternization started and instituted, which would make itself known throughout the world and arrest the attention of the highest minds. So something what should be, let's say, really integrated in thinking around the world, completely on every country, every human being involved in it. And that is, you can be found in the Mahatma letters, letter number 6 in the sequence of Barker, the composer of the first publication, and letter number 12 in the chronological sequence and composition of the letters published in 1994. Is a very nice way of reading, because there, in the last one, all the letters are in sequence of time. To understand the fundamental principle of compassion and universal brotherhood, we have to look in the Seeker doctrine, and we have to look to the three fundamental propositions of the Theosophia, yeah? And give us the direct principle for compassion. And maybe the first one is maybe the most important one. That is boundlessness. Yeah? Everything is there. And it is phrased in the first line as an omnipresent, eternal, boundless, immutable principle on which all speculations is impossible. This one totality concept without a border, without an end, without the opportunity to add something to it, because then it is not infinite anymore, without the opportunity to subtract from it. The very funny thing is that this statement, of course, phrased in the typical, let's call it, theosophical terminology, you find that same idea in, for instance, the Tao Te King of Lao Tse. The first paradox is about Tao. He calls it Tao. And then he starts to describe and he says, Tao, what can be named, is not the true Tao. As soon as you try to express it, then you do it short, because an expression is a limited description and is by this doing, let's say, short on the total concept. Yeah. So this part is so fundamental that here you find the idea that everything, all beings, all, let's say, beings in our worlds and in higher worlds and in lower worlds, infinite in itself, are belonging to that first fundamental principle. And to see the interconnection and the, let's say, solid relation, we cannot, let's say, live without the interconnection. There is a tradition in Africa, and it is called Ubuntu, and they have the expression very much alike and say, I am because we are. Yeah. So I can exist because all the others are there as well. Yeah. And if the others are not there, I cannot exist. The other fundamental principle, the second one, is the cyclicity. That is a very important one. And is also an easy one to understand. So if you start to investigate in your daily life, that one, the second one, you can almost find every moment in every day, because we have cyclicity as 24 hours, day and night, summer, winter, and all the seasons. Yeah, you see, there is in all the activity in life, it is coming and going. And that principle is, let's say, manifested on many, many levels. The year, the Earth going around the Sun, the other planets going around the Sun in interrelations with each other, with the period of 60 years coming back in the same position as 60 years back. So you can see that cyclicity is a very fundamental one. But what she do, and she speaks in the second one, and there is a phrase in it, yeah, the manifestating stars and the sparks of eternity, the sparks of eternity. And that is a certain phrase to try to express, and I will come later on back on it, try to express that in the totality, there starts to be manifestations, and she calls it sparks of eternity. So a spark having a little bit of the first fundamental principle, but a little bit of infinite is infinite. So that spark have a fundamental principle that everything is incorporated in his sparks being. Yeah. And that spell plays a very important role in all the teachings of the Theosophia. And she phrased it in a note in the Secret Doctrine, and the notes explain it a little bit further. And that spark, what is called, let's show you again, the spark, what is called the eternity of the pilgrim. Yeah. And that element, that idea of pilgrim, she explore in the note, in the Secret Doctrine, and there she starts to say pilgrim is a different word for monad. A monad is a term you find in the Secret Doctrine and in our Theosophical literature on many and many places, because that is a fundamental concept to explain what we are. And every being what is able to manifest himself, yeah, you can say the force behind it, the power behind it, is that particular monad. And then the third one is as above, as below. That means that the fundamental laws, what, let's say, are active and executed on higher levels, work on the lower levels as well. So we can say that the laws on all levels are the same. The only difference you can speak of is that we humans exercising these laws or not exercising these laws will do this on our level of understanding and, let's say, development. And the gods, what exercise that laws on their level, will do it on a much more perfect way. We do it on a much more limited way. We are learning to learn to do this on a higher level as well. To show you a little bit what I mentioned with that idea of spark, I give you this example of a fire, and you see the sparks coming from that fire. Yeah. For me, the philosophical disadvantage of speaking of a spark of infinity gives the idea that the spark is coming free from the fire. And that is not the case what we try to say in the first fundamental principle. That spark is always part from that oneness, yeah, the immutable principle. And to become separated is absolutely not the case. It is just a way of speaking that had starts to manifest himself and gives the illusion in his manifestation that he is separated from the totality, but it is certainly not the case. That is the reason I personally prefer another image. And that is, let's say, the vortex in the ocean. The ocean representing the first fundamental principle. And then you see that there is something in that ocean what generates a type of activity what we know as a vortex. Yeah. And you can see, but the beauty, I think, from this example is that the vortex, of course, is completely built out of all the water in the ocean. There is no difference in it. It is only a type of, let's say, densification, condensation, a local activity, what makes it the illusion that it is something on itself. Some other vortexes for inspiring these ideas as well. If you look, for instance, to this one, that the gives also a very nice example of that vertex idea. Yeah. And there you see that on different distance from the center, there exists the same type of vertexes. Yeah. And that is a type of picture what is quite popular, is used very much in the mathematical world. Yeah. And used for illustrations. And if you look from mathematical point of view, to describe this type of pictures is a very, let's say, simple equation to do. But this type of idea you will find back if you take, for instance, a tree, and you take a leaf from the tree, and you study the structure of that leaf, you will find the main structure of the tree in that leaf. Yeah? So that means that the same principle is projected in the small, in the leaf. Yeah? That is another one. Yeah. So there are a number of important conclusions to draw from the three propositions. Infinity. Yeah. Limitlessness or boundlessness. Unity. Not a unity made out of a merging of all different type of small pieces and try to build from there, let's say, something what is infinite, but a fundamental unity what manifests within himself different activities, different focal points, different vertexes, what gives us the illusion that it is separated from the unity, what is not the case. And then, of course, the fundamental identity of each being with that boundlessness, yeah, with the boundless. That means that every being, human being, mineral, in the kingdom, every being have in itself, infinite opportunities, infinite possibilities to let's say, evolved to develop, learned to express and to deploy. Cyclic movement, then of course the periodical experience, appearance and disappearance of the universe, the illusion from coming and going, because it is an illusion. In itself, it always is there, but it only manifests itself on a lower level and withdraw on a higher level. The same like we do with daytime and nighttime. When we sleep, our consciousness is not on this outer world, but is go to the inner world. If we're dying, we go to the inner world and we come back by incarnation and so on. So that is the idea of the vertexes in the infinite ocean and sparks of that particular one fire, what HPB used in the secret doctrine as an example. Circulations, exchange, mutable influence. It is all corporation all over. Yeah? And of course, karmic laws. That means that we are acting within the totality. And if we do something, we generate maybe an imbalance. But the totality is pushing back to us to correct the imbalance. In these situations, I give quite often the example, if you have a huge pond and you jump in it, you generate a lot of waves, they reflect on the walls and they come back to you as a force to correct yourself and make you aware of the fact that you are in a dis or disharmony, in an out of balance with the totality. And the oneness, the logic results from this all, yeah? Corporation, absolute interconnectedness. So, and that brings me to the conclusion here, that all forms of manifestation are local identifications and differentiations of the one. All forms, dus all what we see, all what we can observed in our world, and you can name it, and it is in fact infinity, are just a local identification. You can say, make it more compact, because it becomes visible, it becomes to activity, and it is an all, let's say, a particular expression of the one, differentiation. And the more we evolve, the more we develop ourselves, the more we are able to do right of that particular one. Yeah? But of course, to do right 100% on that one, that means that we have infinite time needed for developing it. And that is, of course, a logical impossibility. Everything is composed. That is another important thing to realize. And that is something what we can see in the second and in the third fundamental principles, that everything works and is able to live in cooperation or only by cooperation with other beings. So no being on which kingdom is able to live completely isolated for the other ones. We all need it. We as humans are a living example of having cooperation with maybe million of other cells, atoms, we have organs, and so on, and so on, and it is only just a small part. So that is the important challenge we have over here. How can you start to think about it? Yeah? How do you are able to recognize it in daily life and see this type of ideas, let's say, working out in daily practice. In small, you can find many, of course, limited examples of this same principle. So this is the thesis we have to test, to research for yourself, yeah? And that is what I say before a little bit as well. Truth can only be determined by yourself. Nobody is able to give you a truth. if you give or if you get some knowledge from other ones, maybe it convinces you and then you start to believe. But it is only untrue of yourself if you are able to incorporate, to copy it in your own thinking, to recognize it, to prove it for yourself in daily life, that it is a fact for you as well. And then it becomes something of yourself. So do not assume of belief, but investigate and experience. Test for yourself. So the assignment, what is coming from this, is try to recognize the three fundamental principles in every daily life. Consciousness principle. Consciousness is the guiding force behind any outer sensible form. Consciousness is an other word of called energy, yeah, or is also, let's say, called other beings, not visible for us, where we have cooperation with, and for instance, take our thinking, our thoughts are living beings, what are fed, attracted by us, and the way we think is the way we are. Self-examination. And to give a very simple test is, ask you the question, are we not a body, but we have a body. On the same moment, if you start to observe yourself, yeah, then you can see that by the concept I have a body, much more things can be explained. The way you think, the way you act, and so on. Yeah. So the problem is not so much in the body. The problem is we have the body, how we control the body, how we deal with the body, and what is the body able to give us as an element, as a tool to be active in daily life. This was the end of the second block. We give you now a break of a few minutes. You can send your questions, and after the break I will answer the questions first. Yeah. Henk, are the questions?
Yeah, sure, Herman. And we start with this question. How can something that is boundless, how can that exist?
Well, that is I must say, a quite deep question. If you realize that existing as we understand this means something manifested, yeah, that is one of the densifications what I just described in my previous block, then you cannot expect that the oneness exists in this type of thinking. So there is not an infinite being. That is one of the, how do you say that, the deeper raadsels. Ik ben het woord kwijt. Ja.
I don't know too.
Ja. Nou, it is one of the deeper questions you can think of course. Yeah. And some Buddhic traditions have tried to answer this, and special the tradition from Nagarjuna speaking about sunyata, emptiness. Yeah. And so you cannot say that the totality exists in the way we understand exist as manifesting itself, because every manifestation is a limit expression within the one. So in that point of view, you cannot say that is possible for the boundless. But the boundless is there. The boundless is real. And all manifestations we know are expressions from that oneness. So it is not a matter of saying it don't exist. Yeah, it is there. It is sick. It exists in itself, but not in terms of our way of thinking. Yeah?
Yeah. Deep one. Sure. Yeah. A riddle with the...
A riddle, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Next question.
Yeah.
Could you say that nature keeps repeating itself?
Yes and no. That are always the better answers, yes and no. Let's try to explain. It repeats itself very seen from fundamental principles. Yeah? So let's say, give an example. All triangles, you can calculate with triangles with the same equation. But all triangles are different. So no triangle is exactly the same. Although the mathematical relations between the sides and the surface are all the same. So from this point of view, you can say that yes, it repeats itself in fundamental way of thinking. Yeah? But all the fundamental way of expressing itself is done on local level, you can say, by limited beings, not fully evolved, and they do that on their own way. So let's say they do that in their imperfect way. Not perfect, but imperfect way. They all try to express the same fundamental principle in their way of, let's say, development, evolution. So, and that is the reason, if you should see human beings, you say the definition of a human being is in principle the same, but in expression, it is depending on the person itself, his way of how going over the cycles, his karmic consequences he have built in many, many manifestations, and so on. He expressing the same principles, but he's doing that on his limited amount of able to express this. So, yes, it repeats itself from principle point of view. No, it is not repeating itself, but we all try to express that on, let's say, our limit way of expressing this. Yeah?
Yeah.
I hope this is clear.
Yeah, otherwise we will see it. Here is a comment. Yeah, a comment. I like the example of the vortex rather than the fire with sparks, yeah. Especially the fractal.
Yeah. Well, let's be very clear. You find in the theosophical world many diagrams. Diagrams designed door Blavatsky and the masters himself. Diagrams later on by followers and successors also, let's say, designed. And what we have to keep in mind in all the examples, and that is true for the spark of infinity and the vertex, of course, it is a way of trying to explain how the totality is working. And you can be sure there is no diagram, schematic representation, what is able to express this in full terms. It is all attempts to try to express. So, also the vertex gets the, let's say, Buddhic idea behind it. And if you start to argument in details, you can certainly find some details that the vertex is not always this or not always that, and so on and so on. I had just in the break a discussion with Henk, and he said, well, a fish in itself is in a certain way also a vertex in the ocean. Because he is composed out all elements in the ocean. And is thus an identification of that ocean, you can say. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Very well. Now here there is some more. This is a kind of semi, or also a kind of scientific question. It is this. I see an analogy between the vortex idea and black holes. In the sense that there is a vortex and a black hole in the center of every atom. Do you think if this could be another way to explain the vortex idea?
Well, I should say thank you very much for thinking along with us. And let's say, yes, I think that we can really make a step in that direction. Maybe we should also realize that the understanding from astronomical point of view, from physics point of view, what is a black hole is really, let's say, on this moment in very much development. There is not a very, complete idea about it. But if you take the two and compare with each other, I think you are really right to see a very, very big similarity. Yeah? And you see also that the astronomical people coming by investigations much closer, or discovery facts they see, much closer to theosophical teachings. But be careful. I say the facts, what they discover. Very often, their conclusions is not in line with the theosophy. But let's say the facts, what they conclude, yes, that is in line. Another example, what is also related to this subject, is that for the last, I think, was 15 years ago, an astronomical lady in Belgium start to investigate that all stars was having a heartbeat. And of course, in the early beginning, a lot of colleagues say, well, that's quite nonsense. But now she was able, after 15 years of research and investigation, to prove that each star is having his own heartbeat. Well, I must say that is really a step in the direction of a theosophical conclusion that everything lived, is alive, and everything works in fundamental principle on the same ideas, what we have discussed before.
Yeah, and there is a last question. It is again about the first question. How can something that is boundless, how can it exist? And now the question is, so it, I think the boundless is meant, the boundless is a kind of existing in another kind of dimension?
No, vice versa. You can say within the boundless, you can find other dimensions of, let's say, life. And that is what I will explain a little bit in the next and the last block when we speak about hierarchies. And the theosophical concept, and I now run a little bit in front of what I have to say, but the theosophical concept is that there is life within life. Yeah? So take the example of a human being. A cell in our life, in our body, is also a living being. And you can say there's another dimension living within human being. Yeah? And have there his cycles and activities and his coming and going, because our, let's say, lower part is a very dynamic something. Yeah. So there are a million of cells coming in and going out. So if you will look to it, then you will be surprised that there still is a body what functions, because everybody is going in and out. But there are a number of them. They are able to maintain the structure. Yeah. And that are the cooperations we have with a few of them to help us in maintaining the structure. Yeah, and there are all very nice names for that type of cells and so on. Stem cells is an example. What is the English word for stem cells?
Stem cells.
Stem cells, that is an example of it, because they are able to control a certain type of cells and keep them in the functionality of a kidney or something else or so. Yeah. So you see exact that what we say in the second and in the third fundamental principles, you see a lot of examples on lower levels. Yeah, and that is what I try to say. If you start to investigate this type of things, then this fundamental principle starts to live for yourself, yeah? And becomes knowledge of yourself.
Those are the questions.
Yeah, that's why the questions.